Last week, scientists did something that wasn't supposed to be possible for another decade. They crammed 25 million quantum components onto a chip the size of your thumbnail. And it works with the same manufacturing processes that make your iPhone processor. This changes everything, and China just responded. The quantum computing race just entered a new phase. For 60 years, quantum and classical computing have been completely separate technologies, different materials, different manufacturing, different physics. You couldn't build them together even if you wanted to. That barrier just fell, and the implications go far beyond faster computers. This is Quantum Silk Road. Let's break down what just happened, why it matters, and what China's doing about it. Here's what most people misunderstand about quantum computers. The challenge isn't just making them work, it's making them work with everything else we've built. Quantum computers operate at temperatures colder than outer space. They require entire rooms of cooling equipment. A slight vibration, a stray electromagnetic wave, even cosmic radiation can cause them to lose their quantum state in what scientists call decoherence. But the real problem? They couldn't integrate with our existing semiconductor infrastructure. Think about it. We've spent 70 years and trillions of dollars building the semiconductor industry. Every chip fabrication plant, every manufacturing process, every engineering standard is built around silicon and germanium semiconductors. Quantum computers used completely different materials, superconducting metals like aluminum and niobium. You couldn't manufacture them in the same facility as classical chips. You couldn't stack them on the same wafer. You couldn't even cool them with the same systems. It was like trying to build a hybrid car when gasoline engines and electric motors required completely different assembly lines, different factories, different supply chains. Until last week, scientists at New York University and the University of Queensland just published something extraordinary in Nature Nanotechnology in late 2025. They created the world's first heavily hole-doped germanium superconductor. And before your eyes glaze over, here's why that sentence matters. Germanium is already used in semiconductor manufacturing. Intel, TSMC, Samsung, they all work with germanium. It's part of standard CMOS fabrication. Germanium has higher carrier mobility than silicon, making it ideal for fast quantum devices. Superconductors are what quantum computers need to create qubits, the quantum bits that do the actual computing. For 60 years, these were separate materials. You had semiconductors over here, superconductors over there, and never the twain shall meet. These researchers figured out how to turn a semiconductor into a superconductor. And the numbers are staggering. Stay with me, because this is where it gets wild. Here's what they did. Using a technique called molecular beam epitaxy, essentially building a crystal atom by atom, they took germanium and replaced one in every 8 atoms with gallium. This isn't standard doping, where you sprinkle in a few impurity atoms to change electrical properties. This is structural transformation. 1/8 of the entire crystal is now a different element. The result? A material that superconducts at 3.5 Kelvin. Why does that matter? Most superconducting qubits today use aluminum, which superconducts at 1.2 Kelvin. Moving from 1.2K to 3.5K reduces cooling costs because dilution refrigerators operate exponentially more efficiently at higher temperatures. This means cheaper infrastructure and more stable operation. But here's the real breakthrough. This is the first time superconductivity emerged inside a semiconductor crystal, not layered on top of it. That means you can now do this. Classical computing layer, quantum computing layer, classical layer, quantum layer, all on the same chip, manufactured in the same facility. They demonstrated 25 million Josephson junctions on a single 2-inch wafer. Today's most advanced superconducting quantum chips, the ones from IBM, Google, Rigetti, they have tens of thousands of junctions. This is a 1,000-fold increase in density. Each junction could be a qubit. Each one could be a sensor. Each one could be a computational bridge between classical and quantum worlds. But there's something else happening here that the researchers didn't expect. Decoherence, the tendency of quantum systems to lose their quantum properties, is the primary reason quantum computers are still limited. environmental noise destroys the delicate quantum states before you can complete a calculation. Germanium has a natural advantage: extremely low nuclear spin noise. The atomic nuclei in germanium don't create random magnetic fields that disrupt qubits. That's why Intel and others have been researching germanium spin qubits. But the NYU Queensland team discovered something additional. The molecular beam epitaxy process creates near-perfect crystals with very few defects. Fewer defects means less decoherence. The very manufacturing technique that enables semiconductor integration also produces more stable qubits. Dr. Javed Shabani, the NYU professor leading this research, put it this way. You have a trillion-dollar silicon germanium infrastructure that can now use superconductivity as a new item in their toolbox. The timeline for solid-state quantum computing could really shrink. And that's just the American side of the story. Because while this was happening, China made an announcement of their own. Pan Jianwei, the physicist Nature Journal calls the father of quantum, just published results from China's Zhuchongzi 2 processor. Zhuchongzi 2 is China's superconducting quantum computer, their answer to Google's Sycamore. It's already demonstrated quantum computational tasks that classical supercomputers can't simulate. But Pan's team just demonstrated something new: higher-order topological quantum states with corner protection. Here's what that means. In normal quantum systems, information is vulnerable to noise from all directions: electromagnetic interference, thermal vibrations, cosmic rays, everything. But in higher-order topological systems, quantum states exist only at the corners of a 2D or 3D structure, and those corner states are naturally protected from environmental noise. Think of it like building a fortress where the walls themselves create a physics-based shield. The topology, the geometric structure, provides protection that doesn't require active error correction. Pan's team calls it quantum armor. And it's the first experimental realization of these non-equilibrium topological phases. Why does this matter? Error correction is the primary bottleneck in quantum computing. Current systems require hundreds or thousands of physical qubits to create one reliable logical qubit, because you need all those extra qubits running error correction algorithms to catch and fix mistakes. If you can create qubits that are inherently more resistant to errors through topological protection, you drastically reduce that overhead. Fewer qubits needed for error correction means more qubits available for actual computation. So now we have two parallel breakthroughs announced within weeks of each other. United States: integration of quantum components with semiconductor manufacturing. The strategy is to leverage America's dominance in chip fabrication, CMOS technology, and the entire semiconductor supply chain. Make quantum computing compatible with the infrastructure that already exists. China: topological protection and high coherence physics. The strategy is to create qubits that are fundamentally more stable through materials, science, and quantum physics. Fields that are harder to restrict through export controls. Export controls cannot stop materials science breakthroughs, which is why China's approach is strategically chosen. Both approaches target the same problem: scaling up quantum computers while reducing decoherence. And both could succeed. This isn't one country pulling ahead. This is parallel development along different technological paths. The US has advantages in semiconductor manufacturing. China has advantages in quantum physics research and materials science. The question isn't who's winning. The question is, what happens when both succeed? Because the real breakthrough isn't just faster quantum computers. It's what happens when quantum and classical computing become seamless. Here's what this enables. Today's quantum computers are isolated systems. You prepare your data on a classical computer, send it to the quantum processor, wait for results, then translate them back. Every step introduces delays and errors. But imagine this: a single chip where classical processors handle everyday computations and route specific problems to quantum accelerators only when needed, then seamlessly integrate the results back. No translation layer, no bottleneck, no isolation. This is already the direction the industry is moving. IBM's roadmap, Google's strategy, Quantinuum's architecture, they're all building toward hybrid classical quantum systems. This semiconductor breakthrough makes it manufacturable at scale. And the applications are staggering. Drug discovery. Quantum simulation of molecular interactions could identify drug candidates in weeks instead of 10-15 years. Climate modeling. Simulating atmospheric chemistry and ocean currents with accuracy impossible for classical systems. Artificial intelligence. Quantum computing enables AI to explore solution spaces with billions of variables, optimization problems that are literally impossible for classical computers. Materials science, designing new batteries, superconductors, and catalysts for clean energy, atom by atom. Financial systems, portfolio optimization, and risk assessment across global markets with quantum precision. But there's one application we need to talk about honestly. Current encryption, RRSA, elliptic curve cryptography, protects everything from your bank account to classified military communications. These systems are secure because factoring large numbers is computationally infeasible for classical computers. But there's an algorithm called Shor's algorithm that, running on a sufficiently powerful quantum computer, breaks these encryption systems. Not in years or months, in hours. This isn't science fiction. The math is proven. We just don't have quantum computers large enough to run it at scale yet. Governments know this. That's why NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, just released post-quantum cryptography standards. Encryption algorithms designed to resist quantum attacks. The race is now between deploying quantum-resistant encryption and the development of cryptographically relevant quantum computers. Whoever achieves scalable quantum computing first doesn't just gain a competitive advantage. They gain the ability to read communications that others believe are secure. That's a civilization-level capability gap. Here's what keeps me up at night. We're not experiencing separate technological revolutions. We're experiencing one massive convergence. Autonomous AI agents are already automating knowledge work and research. Humanoid robots are entering industrial trials. And quantum computing is transitioning from isolated laboratory experiments to manufacturable hybrid architectures. Each technology amplifies the others. AI trained on quantum-enhanced systems could discover patterns in data that classical AI literally cannot see. Quantum simulations could design materials that enable better robots, better batteries, better everything. Robots could automate the construction of quantum computing facilities. 60 years ago, semiconductor quantum integration was theoretical speculation. 20 years ago, researchers tried and gave up. Last week, multiple teams across multiple countries achieved what was considered impossible. This is exponential progress, not steady, not predictable, but sudden and convergent. The timeline is accelerating. This semiconductor breakthrough isn't the end of the story. It's the opening move. Multiple research teams, multiple nations, multiple technological approaches, all converging on the same goal of making quantum computing practical and transformative. The companies and nations that maintain leadership in both semiconductor manufacturing and quantum physics will define the infrastructure of the next technological age. The nation that controls the semiconductor to quantum pipeline will control the computational infrastructure of the next century. And it's happening faster than anyone predicted. This is Quantum Silk Route, tracking the intersection of technology, geopolitics, and the future of computing power. Subscribe, because this race is just getting started.